If we are talking about conservatism and how conservatism has harmed the United States, or how conservatism has helped the United States throughout history, we will see that conservatism could not be traced to the original leaders of America between 1781 to 1788. The leaders of the Confederate government of America under the Articles of Confederation as our first constitution, from John Hanson all the way to Cyrus Griffin, there's little known about conservatism among them. And also, George Washington and John Adams, who were the first two leaders of the United States of America under the federal system of government and the federal constitution, there's not much trace of conservatism in them. Even though Thomas Jefferson has accused these two early leaders as being royal in America, but they were not conservatives. The same way Thomas Jefferson, all the way to John Quincy Adams, there is not much conservatism trace in them. Conservatism became real in America during the time of Andrew Jackson, the first Democratic leader of the United States of America. In 1828, he won the election and came to office. And as a conservative, he believed in the status quo. He believed in the tradition. Conservatives don't want much changes. Even if they want to change, they want to change that will maintain the old standard rather than change for something they are not fully aware or fully sure of. So conservatism came into America under Andrew Jackson. During his time, he brought what we call the spoils system, which distribute jobs to friends and political allies. If you give jobs to friends and political allies, you will be able to maintain your sectional interest. So conservatives always look for the interest of their people. So Andrew Jackson introduced spoils system to make sure he has satisfied all the people within the sections that supported him. In addition to that spoils system, he picked up a wall against the National Bank of the United States of America. He took all the federal money from the banks and put it in state banks because he believed in state rights. Conservatives always believe in state rights. And when he did, what happened? There was economic panic and a depression that affected the economy so bad in the 1830s. Also, he brought what we call sectionalism, divisions politically, economically, and socially. That's what some conservatives believe in, sectionalism, sectional interest that Andrew Jackson brought. So conservatism is always for the interest of their people. So Andrew Jackson did all this for his people. One thing about conservatism in America which was more damaging was the outbreak of the Civil War. Conservative Democrats at that time could not prevent the coming of the Civil War. And the Civil War is a single destructive war in America. Instead of using our intellectualism to move from one stage of development to another stage of development, they allow what Karl Marx said to come true. That if you are moving from one stage of development to another stage of development, conflict is inevitable. And so they waited until conflict did come to solve the problem. We were in the slavery mode of production. And to move to capitalist mode of production, it could have been smooth by using constitutional approaches to solve this problem. But conservatives were not willing. They were prepared to maintain the old order and created the Civil War. And therefore, the Civil War brought destruction. It increased the national debt very high and created a whole lot of problems that had to be fixed. Throughout so many years, between 1860 to 1900, dealing with this problem. So conservatism had actually been harmful in that way. Also, the Democrats ended conservatism at the basis of their ideology to embrace progressivism. So the Republicans, who were progressive in 1912, antagonized the progressives in the party by President Taft. So the progressives in the party left and formed their own political party and called their old president, Teddy Roosevelt, to become their presidential candidate. For the first time in the Democratic Party, they also had a progressive candidate, Woodrow Wilson. So the Republicans were left with conservatives. So conservatives and the Democrats were leaving the Democratic Party to join the Republican Party. That was another split. And therefore, Republicans became conservatives, and the Democrats became progressive. In the Republican conservatism, one thing that they did not do well is to allow the Great Depression to happen. They were solving the problem with more tax cuts, but that was not the solution. The Roaring Twenties that have started during the last end of Woodrow Wilson's time through Hardin and Coolidge ended with President Hoover and eventually created the single most economic problem in American history. The Great Depression happened because of conservative inability to solve the problem or inability to foresee the consequences of where the economy was leading to. So they created the Great Depression, which is not good in the eyes of conservatism. Also, during President Nixon's time, Nixon created unnecessary inflation through his reckless foreign policy. And the inflation that he created went through President Ford, went through President Carter. So that is not good on the record of conservatism. And that was very harmful to American society. Also, conservatives have been responsible for high national debt at a time when the society is at peace, when there is no war. From Nixon, the national debt increased to and above $1 billion. And they went through the same with President Ford. And when President Carter came, the Federal Reserve Bank thought that inflation was a monetary problem and increased the interest rate. And as a result, the same debt was incurred. But guess what? During Reagan's time, there was no war. Reagan cut taxes without cutting down expenditure. And that amounted the debt to $2.8 trillion. There was no war. But more debt was created. Under President George H.W. Bush, also created $1.5 trillion. So now, after that, every leader that comes have to create $1 trillion debt. That is a time when there is no war. You create a debt with a simple policy. And that is not good in the record of the conservatives in America. In that way, they have hemmed America. Also looking at it, when the Republicans became conservatives, job creation had become more difficult. They don't create jobs anymore. There's none of the conservative leaders since the Great Depression, 1929, to today, 2016, 87 years, all conservatives who have come to office, and at the time of leaving office, unemployment is always in recession. The only one that did good was Ronald Reagan. But what did he do? Unemployment numbers came down to 6%, which was still in recession. And so conservative job creation is questionable. And that means that conservatism has been very harmful to America in a way. But is there any way where we say conservatives did something great for America? Yes. Conservatives have been able to have a low inflation. From the time of Harding, Coolidge, Hoover, inflation was relatively low. President Eisenhower created a low inflation. President Reagan ended the inflation that had been created by Nixon through Ford and Carter. So inflation under the conservatives have been relatively low, which is very good in the history of conservatives in America. Also, looking at the foreign policy, Kevin Coolidge saw that American prosperity is based on the peaceful nature of the world. When the world is at peace, America prospers. Conservatism in 1912 exchanged parties. The Democrats, who were conservatives in 1912, had a progressive leader who was Woodrow Wilson. Then President Taft was ultra conservative in the Republican Party. He antagonized the progressives in the party. And when he did, the progressives in the Republican Party left and established their own political party and called upon the former president, Teddy Roosevelt, who was the last progressive to rule in the Republican Party, became the presidential candidate for the progressives. So in the election, we have two progressives, one in Democrat, one in Progressive Party. And then we have President Taft, who was extra conservative. So there was an exchange of ideological positions between these two parties. And when the Republicans became conservatives, have they been too good to America without any harm? But guess what? During the 1920s, getting to the last end of Woodrow Wilson, the economy was improving. So it became known as the Roaring Twenties. So from Woodrow Wilson, President Hardin, President Coolidge, we all know President Hardin's government was full of corruption and scandals, of which Kevin Coolidge came to solve that problem. But when Hoover came to office, he was solving the same economic problem with the same idea of tax cut. Conservatives did not look far. They did not look to see the consequence in the future. So the economy collapsed, often known as the Great Depression. Conservatives caused the Great Depression, which was a single economic harmfulness to American society. It was so harmful, so damaging to America. It was lucky that there was no revolution until Roosevelt came. So more or less, I would say, conservatives under the Republicans had also harmed America by that economic depression of 1929. Also, there was great inflation under President Nixon. Nixon created inflation because of his inefficiency, or if not inefficiency, because of bad judgment in foreign policy, and created inflation that ran through President Ford onto President Carter. And that inflation was created by conservative inability to foresee the future consequence. Also, with the Republicans now becoming conservatives, we can see that there have been high national debt when America is at peace. From President Nixon, the debt increased to $200 and above billion. It ran through the same with President Ford. And when President Carter came, the Federal Reserve Bank thought that the inflation was caused by a monetary issue. So they increased the interest rate to about 20% to discourage borrowing. But that wasn't the issue. With the high interest rate, it also increased the debt in the same amount as Nixon and Ford. President Ronald Reagan did not go to any major war in the world. He cut down taxes, but did not cut down expenditure. So let a high debt, moving the debt into trillions. Reagan alone created $1.8 trillion, adding to the existing debt to be around $2.8 trillion. So creating debt without war by the conservatives. Under President George H. Bush, the same thing, $1.5 trillion. Because of that, it has become a pattern that every president that comes to office have to leave behind trillions of dollars. In today's America, people will talk about the debt under Barack Obama. Even though he's not conservative, but it has been high because we have conservative Congress. We have to think about that and know that Congress also rules in some situations. We will talk about that. But we are now looking at the conservative side of the harm they have caused America. Also, since the Great Depression, no conservative leader has left office without recession. Since 1929 to today, 2016, 87 years ago, all the conservative leaders that has come to office leave office with unemployment at a recession level. The only one that we say he did good was Ronald Reagan. But in his first term, unemployment increased to 10.8%. But getting to the end of his term, unemployment came down to 6%, which is considered to be good. But the worst of the progressives can be considered as the best in the conservative arena in terms of job creation. So here, their job creation numbers are not too good. That makes conservatism a little harmful to American citizens. However, if we condemn conservatism, is there anything good that has come from conservatism? Yes. A lot of things have come from the conservatives, especially dealing with inflation. Conservatives have been able to maintain a relatively low inflation rate. We talk about Hardin, Coolidge, and Hoover. Inflation at that time was so low. Inflation during Eisenhower's time was relatively stable. He stabilized inflation. And Ronald Reagan came and ended the inflation that has gone through Nixon, Ford, and Carter. And all the subsequent conservative leaders have been able to maintain relatively low inflation. That made them to look good when it comes to the economy. They are able to maintain low inflation to make old money count. Old money count. Old money has value. And that's what conservatives have been able to do, which is an excellent way of maintaining the economy. Also, when you look at the foreign policy, conservatives have done some good jobs. Like Kevin Coolidge. According to Coolidge, the prosperity of America depends on peace at international level. So during his time, the Roaring Twenties, the booming economy under Kevin Coolidge was seen by negotiating with world leaders to maintain peace in the world, which is good. And guess what? Ronald Reagan did the same thing. He was like Carter in a special way. He was able to maintain peace in the world. He raised America to high position as the only single power in the world without striking anyone in the world. No war. He raised America so high. So from foreign policy, looking from Kevin Coolidge, and also Eisenhower and Ronald Reagan, they have done well. Even though the first Bush took us to war, the second Bush also took us to war, which has tarnished the image of America. But when we look at Kevin Coolidge and Ronald Reagan, as well as Eisenhower, our foreign policy, with these three leaders, who were conservatives, made America a better society. Also, when we look at conservatism, these things make conservatives to be more desired or more desirable to be in American politics. Conservatism here, therefore, is good, even though they have their harmful part, but they also have something good for America. They are able to help America to maintain the American Constitution. Even though the first conservatives and then the Democrats were prepared to destroy the Constitution by the Civil War, but when you look at the later conservatives, they have been able to maintain the order. They have been able to maintain, especially through the Supreme Court, maintaining the system, maintaining order, maintaining the economic approach, using Adam Smith's capitalist approach. And that is conservatism. They have done very well in those areas in maintaining the old order in the society. Ronald Reagan is a unique individual. He's a unique politician. Ronald Reagan's era is a mixed bag. He had a good part and also some areas that need critical analysis, that need critical evaluation. But in all, we say that Ronald Reagan is great. Some people say he is underrated. Some people also say he's overrated. Let us look at those who say Reagan is underrated. Yet, to some extent, Reagan is underrated. Why am I saying this? Look at what made Reagan successful. He maintained a world peace without a major war. He created regional balances. If Iran and Iraq balance each other, Israel, Egypt balance each other, Afghanistan and Russian border, they balance each other. Everywhere he established balances. But when around with that kind of mouth, threatening people, but that was his style. But technically, he never liked war. In Lebanon, about 300 Americans were killed. Ronald Reagan did not strike. If it is today, we will say, hey, Obama, go to war. 300 Americans have been killed, go to war. If 10 Americans are killed, Obama, go to war. But nobody told Reagan to go to war when 300 people have been killed in Lebanon, because he was peaceful. He was peaceful in a special way that people did not know. He left Lebanon not because he was a paper tiger, but he was shrewd. Shrewd to maintain American economy. Shrewd to make America great, because a great power should not exercise power over little issues, over little societies. A great society only fight war as the last resort. Only fight great wars, not unnecessary war, not scapegoating wars. Ronald Reagan was not a paper tiger, but he was shrewd, and as a result, was able to maintain peace in the world in his era. Let's look at what he said. According to him, peace is not absence of conflict. It is the ability to handle conflict by peaceful means. That was Ronald Reagan. That shows that he was peaceful and was able to maintain world peace. No matter how his style was, he did it. And as a result of this, Ronald Reagan was able to raise America so high to be a hegemon as the sole superpower in the world. He did not use war, but he used different strategies. I don't even think modern Republicans understand Reagan, because Reagan has his own special way of doing things. And he prevented war at all costs. To him, war will be the last resort. So peace doesn't mean there's no conflict, but the way we handle conflict by peaceful means, that was Ronald Reagan. Reagan also brought down inflation that has been caused by Nixon, which passed through Ford and passed through President Carter. Reagan was able to bring inflation down to the time of Eisenhower of 2%, which was excellent about him. Also, Reagan solved the immigration problem. For a very long time, no one has a passage to citizenship, just like that. And Reagan was able to solve the immigration problem by giving the immigrants the right to citizenship, a passage to citizenship, which was one excellent deed of Ronald Reagan, because immigrants play an important role in American economy. They do very well in American economy. They contribute. So Reagan saw the importance of these people, and he solved that problem. Also, Reagan appointed women, appointed a woman to the Supreme Court. That was wonderful about Ronald Reagan. He was very tough on children. If we had been tough on children, we would not be observing what we have been observing today among the children of today. A child can pick up a gun and go to school and kill people, right? We gotta be tough. And Ronald Reagan wants everybody to be tough. Be tough on the children, so that when you give them tough love, they become good citizens. And to maintain the rich culture, to maintain the civilization of the United States of America. And Ronald Reagan did excellently in these areas. But also, when we look at it, is there any part of Reagan that wasn't too great? Let's look at it. He cut down taxes for the rich. And the idea of cutting down taxes was to make sure that the rich make more investment and hire people. But it did not happen that way. The tax cut money became like a social welfare money for the rich. It became like a safety net money for the rich and did not create jobs. Because of that, the tax cut, Reagan did not cut down expenditure because he thought with the tax cut, there will be more employment. People will work and pay more taxes. So as a result, he was expecting the return to be good, but it did not turn out to be good. So he left a high debt. He created $1.8 trillion without war and added to the existing debt to be $2.8 trillion. That is one area Reagan did not do very well, or he did not foresee the consequence of that tax cut. Also, when you look at unemployment, from history we have known that unemployment had been very high under conservative leaders. So if Reagan had been in office for one term, his job creation numbers would have been worse and worse. President Carter did excellently well compared to Reagan's first term, but he was in office only for one term and brought unemployment down to 5% level. And so we say Reagan, his first term unemployment numbers were bad, 10.8. But by the time he was leaving office, unemployment came down to 6%. 6% still in recession level, but among all the conservatives, that was the best. Reagan was able to do that. However, unemployment numbers weren't too great, as we always see. So those who say Reagan is overrated, he's overrated when we say that Reagan created jobs. But looking at the numbers, it wasn't too great. So Reagan here is overrated. Then also, in his time, there was an increase of incarcerations because of being tough on crimes in the society, which is good. Which is good. It led to high incarceration. It was also good. But some say he was overrated in that area because of the discrimination by the law enforcement body. But looking at it, looking at the good side of Reagan and the bad side of Reagan, when we say Reagan was a tough leader and he did more good than harm because he raised America so high to be a hegemon, the only sole superpower in the world. And we can use that superpower position to get everything we want. But later generation, later leaders have misused the hegemon that was established by Reagan and making the hegemony stabilization theory a little bit useless, which is a political science theory. And the way we have used the hegemon, we haven't used it very well. Reagan created the hegemony to make America great, but we are not able to handle it. So, looking at Reagan, he did very well. At the same time, there were areas which fall short. So, he's not all that underrated. And in some way, he's not all that overrated. He was balanced. Reagan was great in that way. If blacks are supporting the Democratic Party, is it wrong to do that? There's more questions. When blacks are supporting Democrats, I think they are in the right way. Why? In the 1860s, Abraham Lincoln and those who fought the conservatives were not conservatives. Abraham Lincoln and all those that followed him were progressive, were liberals, libertarians, and all other groups in the Republican Party. At that time, the Republican Party represent America, because America is a pluralistic society. And as a pluralistic society, a party that has a lot of group interests within it is the one that represents the society. So the Republican Party that liberated the black people or African Americans and also look into minority interests in America between 1860 and 1912 were progressives, were liberals. They were not conservatives. But why is it that today the blacks are supporting the party that did not have their interests at stake? We all know Democrats from Andrew Jackson's time to 1912 were conservatives. But in 1912, there was an exchange of political ideology. Conservatism moved into the Republican Party. Progressivism and liberalism all moved into the Democratic Party. Some were even socialists. Some are libertarians. Some in the Democratic Party are conservatives. So the Democratic Party became a party that embraced the plurality of America. America is a pluralistic society. And any party that embraces so many ideological positions is a true representation of America. Because of that, if the blacks and other minorities are supporting the Democratic Party, they are supporting their group interests. The group that liberated them, the group that take care of their interests, are no longer in the Republican Party, but they are in the Democratic Party. And that's why they give 90% allegiance to the Democratic Party. Is it wrong? No. This is not about the parties. It's about the interests of the society. Anyone that takes care of the poor, anyone that takes care of the people, anyone that takes care of America as a whole is what they are looking for. So the blacks support progressives. They support liberalism. They support element of liberal conservatives, and sometimes even socialists. To some extent, there could be some communists even in the party. But because it's an all group interest coming together into the Democratic Party, the blacks are supporting the real people that liberated them in 1860. So they are not on the wrong side. They are on the right side by supporting progressives, because progressives are always at their back, whether they are in the Republican Party or they are in the Democratic Party, they are always there for them. And therefore, they don't want to turn their back to them, because if they do, which means they are embracing the group who do not care about them. Therefore, blacks supporting Democrat Party is real. Very realistic. Support the group. You support the idea. The idea that liberates you. The idea that gives you what you want. Not the idea that will throw you out. So they are supporting the right group as at this time. Is the American Confederacy hate or heritage? Is it really hate or heritage? When some people take Confederacy, they always say, oh, that is about slavery. Some others also see Confederacy as a way of superiority. That is crazy. Confederism or Confederacy has nothing to do with slavery, had nothing to do with black people as a whole. Why am I saying this? Confederacy is a system of government. There are only three systems of government in the world: unitary, confederate, and federal. Because of this, the Iroquois Indians have practiced Confederacy. America, as a young nation after the independence, saw that the Iroquois Confederacy would be a system of government that would help the states to come together in a union. Why did they want that? Americans at that time looked at unitary system as a way of ruling the people tyrannically. So to prevent tyrannical rule, they wanted a government that can be limited. And Confederacy is a limited government. It put limitation on the government. It made the central government a little more weaker as a union. It made the state governors more stronger. So the central government is at the mercy of the state government. Within the era of Confederacy in America between 1781 to 1788, the Constitution of the United States were the Articles of Confederation. That was the first Constitution of America. The Articles of Confederation and the first system of government was Confederacy. It was through the experience of Confederacy that the Constitutional Convention was called. It was called to strengthen the Confederacy. Also, some leaders went to prevent strong central government. And out of that, they came out with a new constitution altogether, which is the federal system of government, which made the central government a little more stronger than the Confederacy. So therefore, Confederacy here is a heritage to America. Historians don't want to talk about this to the children in high school. But in the books, it is well written. In government books, in history books, they are well written that Confederacy was the first system of America. And therefore, the Articles of Confederation were the first constitution of America. The second system of America is federalism. And the second constitution is the federal constitution. Having said this, Confederacy, therefore, is a heritage, and it should not be hatred. But at what point did Confederacy become bad to Americans? That was during the Civil War. Why did the Southerners decide to take Confederacy? They want Confederacy because it's a loose association of union. Therefore, if a state doesn't like what is in the union, that state can break away. That state can secede without any consequence from anyone. But in the federal system, you cannot secede. If you want to break away, there is a consequence, and that will lead to civil war. So the sadness saw that it will be easy for them to adopt Confederacy rather than the federal, so that they can justify their break from the Union. So at this point, if somebody is raising a flag of the Southern Confederacy, he or she is raising a war flag, not the original Confederacy of America. And so Confederacy should not be related to black people. It's a system of government. It's not a system of black people. But because the Southerners wanted to maintain slavery as a mode of production, they want Confederacy to do that. It doesn't mean that the Confederacy is related to black people. It's not. So people should stop using Confederacy to say, oh, that's about slavery, that's about black people. People should stop using Confederacy to look superior and to look at other people as inferior. That is a wrong mentality. That's wrong education. Wrong education. That's miseducation. Confederacy is a system of government. And our American experience in the first Confederation moved into the federalism and make the society better. And so Confederacy, as our first system of government, is not what entails today as we relate Confederacy to black people. That's not true. Confederacy is not black people. Confederacy has nothing to do with black people. The Southerners want to adopt it just because they want a loose association of union, so they can break away and do whatever they want. That's all about it. So people should stop using Confederacy to develop superiority feelings and inferiority feelings. It's a heritage at this point. Historians and political scientists should teach this to the children in the high school so that it will not develop any hatred. Europeans have been fighting all the time, 100 years war, 30 years war, 10 years war, 5 years war, but they still come together. Today we have European Union. How can that be? They have forgotten the past and have come together. So if America have come together, let them also forget the bitterness of the past and don't relate system to a group. A system is a system. Do we mean Russian Confederacy, as they have it today, relates to inferiority or superiority? No, it's not like that. Therefore, Confederacy in America should be a heritage and not hatred. Sometimes it is really difficult to advise great politicians, but no matter what, they need advice, they need directions, they need the citizens' opinion, what they want, because they represent you. They are there by your consent. Because American system is the popular sovereignty. By your consent, they are elected to rule. And so they have to know what you want for them to be there. And if we are to advise any Democrat that wins election in the 21st century to be in the White House, what are we going to tell that Democrat leader? For instance, if Hillary wins, and any other Democrat that wins to the White House, we have to tell that individual that we need job creation. Why are we giving them this responsibility if they are Democrats? Because they claim to be progressives. They claim to be liberals. Since the Great Depression, 1929, to today, 2016, it is only progressive liberals who have been able to create employment to fall below the natural rate of unemployment, or what we call the full employment level, with the exception of two, that is President Carter and President Obama. But even when we look at that, President Carter's numbers came down to 5% level, and Obama's numbers have come down to 4% level. If we are to compare that to the other group, who are the Republicans and conservatives, President Carter will have been a great job creator among all the Republican leaders from 1929 to today, 2016. If Obama were to be a Republican, if he is a Republican, his job creation numbers will have been the best among the Republican leaders. And Carter will have been very good among the Republican leaders, so they can create jobs to bring unemployment below the full employment level. So we have to tell them to continue to create jobs, because Americans need jobs. So if you're a Democrat and you win the White House, the first thing you got to do is to create jobs, because Americans love working. The next thing also we can tell the Democrats to do is to reduce the debt of this nation, because the debt is increasing to some astronomical numbers. Is the debt real numbers or just imaginary numbers? If they are real numbers, then we have to tell them to reduce our debt. Is there any model for any Democratic leader to follow to reduce the debt of America? When we look at history, we can say you can follow President Truman's approach by creating $9 billion surplus. That was good. Or we can look at Kevin Coolidge by creating $6 billion surplus. That was good. Or we can look at Eisenhower by creating $4 billion surplus. That was excellent. Or we can look at the last days of Woodrow Wilson creating $3 billion surplus. That was excellent. We can also look at Hardin creating $2 billion surplus. Not too bad. And Hoover creating $1 billion surplus. Also is something. But do we have any model that the present Democrats can follow, which can reduce the debt of America drastically? Yes, there is one. And that was Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton and Newt Gingrich did a good job. He raised the revenue base of the government. And Gingrich also reduced the expenditure base of the government. And guess what? The first year of the second term of Clinton, they were able to balance budget. The second year, they created $69 billion. The third year, they created over $120 billion. Then the final year, they created over $200 billion surplus. That was excellent. This is the model that any modern Democrat to win the White House should follow. And if you follow that, you will do a great job for America by reducing the debt of America, because the debt rate is becoming more dangerous. It's not helping savings. Why? Because the Federal Reserve Bank had to accommodate the fiscal policy by not increasing the debt, by increasing interest rate. So interest rate has been very low. When it is too low, it doesn't encourage savings. And when there is not much savings, it prevents new investment. And so we want Democrats looking at the model left by Bill Clinton, William Jefferson Clinton. That is a model they can look at and then follow to create jobs, to create surplus for America. We need that surplus to reduce our debt. Other than that, the debt is going up unnecessary. Unnecessary. Cut it out. If there is war affecting that, cut that wall out and find people with diplomatic skills to solve international problems. Solve the debt problem if you are a Democrat who wins the office of the White House. Also, we will say that maintain steady inflation. The way the debt is going up, and at the rate of the interest rate today, there is always the fear of inflation. So any Democrat that goes to office, be careful and make sure to maintain relatively low inflation, as all other leaders have done, to make old money to look good. Also, if you're a Democrat and you win the White House, you have to maintain world peace. President Carter was a master of peace. He tried to maintain peace in the world. President Roosevelt, Teddy Roosevelt, they've all been good as progressive in maintaining world peace. And as progressives, war should be the last resort. Like Woodrow Wilson or Franklin Roosevelt, last resort. War is the last resort. So any Democrat going to office, try as much as possible to maintain world peace. Because peace in the world is to the prosperity of America. Also, if you win office as a Democrat, you have to take care of the health care. Right now we have health care operating in America called Obamacare, or what they call affordable care. It is not perfect, but it has done a good job. What is left, continue. If rates are going high, deductible going high, prescription drugs going high, it's up to you as a Democrat leader to find ways and means to bring all those numbers down for the benefit of every American. So healthcare is your area. You better do it. If you're a Democrat and you win the White House, it's your duty. Because other people don't care about health care. They don't care about everybody's health care. But you care about everybody's health care, then try as much as possible to cut down the cost for everybody in the society. To know that you really mean business to maintain the health of the society. So improve health care. And also, if you win as a Democrat to the White House, you have to ensure that there's justice in America. There should be a good relationship between the police and the general public. The police is the militia. They should have rules in how to control their guns. Call the police. Let them have good education, if some of them are losing it, so that they will know how to communicate with the community to ensure that the police work become more beneficial to the society. We need justice in the society. So if you're a Democrat, this is your area. Because you are progressive, you are liberal, you are all in everything. You have every bit of ideology in the party. So we want more justice in the society. Also, as a Democrat, you want the welfare of the people. So there must be equal pay. Equal pay between men and women doing the same job. For everybody to be satisfied. That's your responsibility. You gotta do it. Because you have promised the people that you can do it. It's your area. Therefore, do it. If you go to White House, any Democrat within the 21st century and beyond, that is your responsibility to make sure that every American receives equal pay. Also, we have to make sure that you reduce crime. There is too much crime going on in the society. Everywhere firearms kill people. In a year, we will have about 3,600 people killed by firearms. In 10 years, we can have over 300,000 Americans killed by firearms. And we claim to be the most peaceful nation in the world. And the way we kill each other, we want crime to go down. So there should be a better relationship, a better control of guns in the society. Even though we defend the Second Amendment, but the Second Amendment doesn't mean children must have access to guns. But today, children have access to guns in the street. When we say Second Amendment, it doesn't mean that people who have mental problems should have guns. Control that. People who have criminal records, control that. People who are related to some kind of terrorism, control that. So that the guns can go to the rightful people. The innocent people who have guns are not dangerous. They protect themselves with the guns from the bad ones. So if you come to office as a progressive liberal, it's your responsibility to ensure gun control. And let the people who deserve to hold guns, who deserve to bear arms, should have the arms that they need. And those who don't need, make sure to prevent it. Children don't need it. They don't have the mind behind the guns. They can fire at any time. And therefore, it's your duty as a Democrat going to the White House to provide America a safe environment and a better environment. If you are also a Democrat who is progressive liberal, we need a better education. You can wear your social science goggles and look through the society and see what is wrong in today's education and solve it. We all know you can do it. Call the general meetings of all educators or education leaders. Call intellectuals and talk about it. Come out with a decision and solve education problem in America. If you are a Democrat winning the White House in the 21st century and beyond. Also, if you are a Democrat and you take the White House, we want you to tackle the immigration issue. Today, nobody wants to care about immigrants. Immigrants are human beings. They contribute a lot to the American economy. They mean a lot to Americans, to the farmers, to other jobs that Americans don't want to do. They are there to do it. Help them so that people don't take advantage of them, so that they can also pay taxes to the federal government. But if they are undocumented, people take advantage of the federal government and pay them peanuts, taking advantage of them and taking advantage of the federal government and not paying taxes to the government. So we have to tackle immigration issue. If you are a Democrat, liberal, progressive, do it. Because Ronald Reagan came from a progressive liberal state as a governor, when he came, he solved the immigration issue and gave people a passage to citizenship. Even though he claimed to be conservative, but he was able to work with progressives. That's why we call Reagan Democrats. He was able to work with both groups of people and able to do the right thing. So today, if people don't care about immigrants, if you are progressive liberal, you have to care, because America is a land of immigrants. And immigrants build this society, and therefore give them a chance. And also, if you're progressive, liberal, we will say fix the infrastructure of America. Bridges are deteriorating. Roads are deteriorating everywhere. We need better roads, better infrastructure, better schools. We want you to fix it. We believe that you can do it. So in the 21st century, any Democrat that wins to office, or if today Hillary Clinton wins to the White House, we want you to fix the infrastructure in America, because they are breaking down. If they break down completely, America will look terrible. We are a society that everybody is looking at. And if we can't fix our own infrastructure, that's a big problem. You can do it, and that's what the society wants you to know, what you have to do to satisfy them. And you being a leader to be glorified by doing these things as a Democrat. On the other side, if you are a Republican and you win office, you win the White House, and if you go there, whether you are Donald Trump or anyone who is a Republican conservative who wins that office, the office of the White House, what do you have to do to please the people that gave their consent for you to be their leader? First of all, Americans love jobs. They like to work. They love to work. So if you go there as a Republican, we want you to create jobs. Reagan was doing it, but it came late in his second term. If it had started from the very beginning he came, he could have created more jobs than before. But his tax cut policy, people did not take the measures upon which the tax cut was meant for. So it became a little disaster. But despite that, in his second term, he did very well to bring unemployment from 10.8 down to 6%, which is good. That's why I'm saying that if you are a Republican and you win to the White House, you have to create jobs because Americans love to work. Also, if you win, the tax cut policy have to be examined critically because the tax cut policy has become like a social welfare money for the rich, a safety net for the rich. They get the money and will not create any job. Individuals work, get wages and salaries, and they are taxed, payroll tax. How is the businessman taxed? The businessman's tax is based on the business person's what? Profit. If you have profit, you got to pay tax. Some business people invest in financial institutions, so they come out with interest. If the interest is high, that is their income, which has to be taxed. Some also invest in land, in machinery, and in housing. So they receive rent. If that is so, rent is an income which has to be taxed. So the rich people get money through this, and they have to be taxed. And so having paid the tax, the money is for the government. So if you are cutting down taxes, is the government money, government revenue, which is being given to the rich people. So we have to examine the tax cut policy. It's not yielding the results that we really want. So if you cut down taxes, like the way Kennedy did, by cutting down taxes for rich people, for the middle class, for the lower class, that will generate more economic activities in the society. So we have seen that the tax cut to the business people is becoming a social welfare money for the rich. So we got to tone down that aspect if the society is not improving by the tax cut policy. We can go both ways, either tax cut or increase tax. Whatever you find yourself good as a Republican, you got to do it and make sure to improve the economy of this country. Also, if you are a Republican, you have to prevent any increase in inflation. Because that is your area, you are too good at it. Ever since Republicans became conservatives, they are too good in preventing inflation, other than Nixon and Ford. Every Republican have been able to maintain relatively inflation rate. So this is an area you are so good. Continue to maintain that to improve the economy, to make old money count. And that will be good for the society. If you are a Republican, I would say try as much as possible to reduce the debt of America. How will you do it? We have to learn from Newt Gingrich by reducing expenditure. You all believe in reducing expenditure to create surplus. Why don't you do it? So if you're a Republican, you can reduce the debt of America, not always going there to increase the debt of America by creating other unnecessary war by President George Bush, who left a legacy that whoever be the next president, no matter what, you can reduce debt. Because for 10 years, we still have war. And so it's difficult to reduce the debt. Unnecessary things that create debt, cut it off. As a Republican, cut expenditure to improve the economy so as to reduce the debt of America. Also, if you are a Republican, solve the immigration issue. Although we have learned from modern politicians, particularly with Donald Trump, who want to build a wall to solve the immigration issue, is the wall the only way to solve the immigration issue in America? I don't think so. There are other immigrants who are here that did not come through Mexico. They are here to work. They are here to advance themselves. They are here to taste the American dream. So the immigration issue, learn from Ronald Reagan, what he did. If it is good, do it. And help some immigrants to maintain status. If not, help others with legitimate papers or help them to be recognized in the society so that they will not be hiding. They will not work and hide and being paid under the table. No. Solve the immigration problem. Ronald Reagan has given us an example, a model to emulate, a model which can guide us to solve the immigration problem. So if you're a Republican, you have a model already. Follow it and then modify the model in a way that it can suit American society. It should not only be one way, but it could be multiple ways in solving the immigration problem of America. So if you're a Republican and you win the White House, that's your responsibility. Help solve the immigration problem. Not only by building walls, there are other approaches, which is good. Not only by deportation, but there are other ways you can use to help people who are more productive in American society. Also, if you are a Republican, we want you to maintain relative peace in the world. Is there any model for us? Is there any example for any Republican today who may win to the White House? If we don't know, let's look at Kevin Coolidge. For he believed that American prosperity depends on peace at the international level. Ronald Reagan also saw that peace in the world is to help America prosper. With the peace in the world under his time, he moved America to become a hegemon, the only sole superpower in the world. But later people had misused the superpower position. Because as a superpower, we don't use the superpower to go to unnecessary wars, like war in Iraq. That was unnecessary, because Iraq had nothing to do with 9/11. With the 9/11 issue, we could have charged Saudi Arabia to contribute something to help 9/11 victims, like he did in the Lockerbie incident. We push Gaddafi to pay for the Lockerbie incident. And so instead of going through the proper channel, we use Iraq as a scapegoat, and it has destroyed the peace of the world. And now sometimes some people are trying to blame the Democrats. It is this unnecessary approach of using the hegemon that brought all these problems. And so if you are conservative, learn from Ronald Reagan, because he said peace is not absent of conflict. It's the way conflict is managed by peaceful means. That's Ronald Reagan. And if Ronald Reagan is the hero of the Republican conservatives since 1912, then we have to emulate his example. If you are a Republican and you win the White House, what again can you do for Americans to be pleased with your leadership? Unemployment. Reduce it. Bring unemployment down. Right? And then make sure the world is at peace. Look, sometimes we depend on our emotions to move Americans into war. During Ronald Reagan's time, 300 Americans were killed in Lebanon. Nobody pushed him to war. Nobody could push Reagan. He was a man of himself. He was shrewd. He has given us all this model. Let us follow for the prosperity of America. And make sure through that we can also reduce unemployment. So we say that as Republicans, if we win the White House, these are some of the things you got to do to make Americans well pleased with your leadership. Because you are conservative, you are unique, individual. You are unique in maintaining the order. So why don't you help Americans to find what they want? That's what they want you to do. So if you are a conservative Republican, Americans expect much from you. So do it, so that your leadership will be glorified. Still, we say that if you're a Republican and you win the White House, what again can you do to please Americans? Americans want good negotiation in trade. We don't have to antagonize other countries. We don't have to start any trade war, either with China, with Russia, or any nation, which is giving us a tough time. No, we have to negotiate very well. And when we are negotiating, we have to think about comparative advantage instead of absolute advantage. Comparative advantage, we are in a global world and global competition. And so when we are negotiating, we also have to take other people's interests into consideration and make sure to balance trade. Look at it. If NAFTA is not working good, it doesn't mean that the intention behind NAFTA was bad, but just because it has not worked to the advantage of America. We are in a global world, and therefore something that has not worked well with America, we modify it. We go into new negotiations and then modify the part which has not worked for Americans. So we need good trade relationship with other countries. And also, if you're a Republican, you have to fix the broken schools in America. American education is falling. And if you believe in standard, if you are conservative, who believe in order, who believe in the old system, then the old system is better than today. If you believe in the old system, you got to fix the educational system of America. Don't throw in any unnecessary solutions like talking about voucher, talking about no common core. These are not solutions. America needs a common curriculum to guide all states. We have great intellectuals who can come up with wonderful curriculum. And curriculum is an ongoing process, and it has to be changed over time. So we need something to guide. Those are not solutions to say that we don't need a common core or we need voucher system. Those are not solutions. I've already talked about that. And you have to look at it. How to face the broken educational system. Look at the inner city. How education is rotten. And a rotten education will tell you what kind of society you got. Because without education, there is no problem that can be solved without it. Education is an ornament in prosperity and a refuge in adversity. So we got to face it. So if you are a Republican, you have that responsibility. Don't solve education through sectionalism. Solve it through entire society. Let intellectuals work it out. Education shouldn't be a business. Shouldn't be run like a business. That's what we have to do to fix the broken educational system. Also, looking at American economy, you don't have to run American economy like the way individuals run business, because business is profit oriented, profit maximization. But government is not run on that basis. Government does not depend on profit to operate. Government depends on tariff and taxes. So don't run the government as the way individuals run businesses. There's difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics. Run the country on a macro basis rather than running the country on micro basis. If you're able to differentiate the two, you'll be able to do better. As a Republican, everybody believes in the Second Amendment, gun issues. But gun issue does not mean foolishness. Gun issues is something to be taken serious. There is a word in the Second Amendment, well-regulated militia, which means when the militia have guns, they have a mind behind the guns, and they don't use it anyhow. As a result, because everyone has the right to bear arms, they should also have a mind behind it. People who don't have mind behind the usage of guns must be controlled. Children from ages of 8 to 20 must be controlled. They don't have to have access to guns. But today's world, the youth have guns. Some of them can even take it to elementary school and kill their fellow students and some teachers. Because of these senseless killings, we have to control guns from people who are not supposed to hold guns. And we all know them. Criminals, people on terrorist lists, children, people with mental disability. We have to control that. And I know in this area, both Democrats and Republicans agree. So if it is so, if you're a Republican and you go to office, make sure the right people have access to guns. And when the right people have access to guns, they use the gun to protect themselves. They are not dangerous because they are right people. Defend the Second Amendment with shrewdness. Also, if you're a Republican and you win to the office, build American military. But don't build the military in a way that you take them to war unnecessarily. Ronald Reagan built American military, didn't take the military to war. He just strengthened the base. So we have to strengthen the military. But that doesn't mean that we have to fish around looking for war. That is not what it means. And also, if you are a Republican, you have to look around and see our infrastructure. It's falling apart. Be more diligent, be more shrewd, and fix infrastructure before they break down. Just look at Hurricane Katrina. It made America to look like a third world country. We don't have to let that to happen. Let's plan ahead. If you are a Republican, hey, this is the area you can do best. And if you win to the White House, fix the infrastructure of America. In that way, your government will be glorified. And the people will be pleased with you as a leader of America. So that is what to you, if you are a Republican leader who may win to the White House one day. Let's do this. And you'll be praised. You will have a place in history. In our world today, we really need peace. We need peace in the world. So whether you are a Democrat or a Republican leader, if you win to the White House, we need real peace. Peace for the world. America has been a peaceful society. America has been a society which is so benign. Everybody look at America as an example. But why have we turned out to be more belligerent these days? We all know the war in Iraq, to some extent, can be a criminal act. To some extent, we can say it's in good order. No matter where we take it from, we have to do better. We have to examine issues critically before we make a decision to go to war, rather than going to war and regretting later. Many Americans have regretted today by going to Iraq. So we have to have good training in diplomacy. Look, in 1884, Bismarck of Germany used diplomacy to prevent war in Europe and Africa. The scramble for Africa would have led to great war in Europe. But Bismarck used his diplomatic skills and prevent any war in Europe and in Africa. That was great. We need people with great diplomatic skills in America. And war should be only taken as the last resort. It happened during Woodrow Wilson's time. He did not enter the First World War immediately as the war broke out. He waited and waited and waited until situations got out of hand, that American entering the war was justifiable. Also, we look at Franklin Roosevelt. The Second World War broke out in 1939. He didn't even know which side to support. He waited and waited and waited until Pearl Harbor was bombed by Japan. And if America was going to fight Japan, then by alliance system, anywhere Japan support, America will fight. That's why America went to war against Germany, because Japan was a friend or was in alliance with Germany. So the war was used as a last result. Let us do that and prevent unnecessary war. All this Arab Spring and all that, leave those people in peace and deal with them diplomatically. If it is Africa going to kill Gaddafi, what was the use? Africa is a continent and it have leadership, it has a union. Communicate with the leaders within the union and see how best to solve the problem. Gaddafi came to office without spilling his blood. He did not spill blood, bloodless coup, and he came to office. If he looked very bad in the eyes of the world, find ways and means to deal with these leaders and make sure that the society can move on smoothly from one leader to another. Human beings are human beings. They can always listen to others. We don't need to kill people unnecessarily to create unnecessary conflict and chaos in other areas, which comes back to us. Because if they are running away from their country, we got to take the immigrants. And we don't want immigrants, right? So it is time for us to look into how diplomatically we can use to solve the world's problem. We need it, whether you are a Republican or you are a Democrat, our foreign policy approach must change. We must move away from belligerency to a benign society that everybody wants to emulate. We have to demonstrate real civilization rather than thinking about wars and wars and wars all the time. War is not the answer. Education is the answer. Education is the answer. So if we go to war and allow our education to fall, we are damaging the civilization that has been built over a long period of time. We need peace in the world. And therefore, all Democrats and Republicans alike should come together and think at intellectual level how to solve problems. We can transfer our democracy into the United Nations and let United Nations solve smaller problems. These little countries, we don't have to fight them. Let United Nations solve those problems. We have organizations. Let NATO solve that problem. War is always not the answer. We are in a civilized world. We have to demonstrate that we are civilized. And if we are civilized, refrain from unnecessary wars, and then lay down conditions for high diplomacy to ensure peace in the world. And that's why America will prosper. And that's why other countries will prosper. Let us avoid unnecessary competition for nothing. Help other economies to grow. And if other economies are growing, we are at advantage. We want world peace. So let us do better at international level. Access will not be a problem if we cease fire. Use diplomacy and bring them together. They are fighting. When will the war stop? It will not, unless we communicate with them. In Afghanistan, without Taliban, there will be no peace. They are piece of the problem. They are part of the problem and the solution. You can't leave them out. You can't wipe them out. You can't annihilate a group. Annihilation is a complete evil. Bring them to round table and let them establish peace. In Iraq, let them establish peace. In Syria, establish peace. We have to team up with any power that wants to establish peace. We want it. Please. Our leaders think and be shrewd in solving the world's problem. Prove to the world how benign the United States is.